then that's how Satan can get in there. See? All you need is one avenue for Satan. So it's a little leaven. Leaven's the whole thing. All you need is one avenue. See? So a brother can sound well and speak well and everything. He can have a school. He can have maybe draw lots of brothers in the, and it's no good. So that's why on the Passover, the Mosai said no unleavened bread. Now, if you got a piece of bread in there somewhere, that got through there somewhere, one little piece, the whole thing is unclean. See? The whole thing is unclean. It's like, it's no good. I mean, the whole temple, everything. If you somehow...
We're not Christians. We're not Muslims. We are Hebrew Israelites. We're from the seed of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We're following Yahuwah.
Yahuwah.
Okay. You will say it right. Practice it one time with me. Yahuwah.
That's been said by Europeans who promoted this madness. Who turned around and told us that this is God. This is a representation of the Son of the Most High. And this is what we believe in. His name wasn't even Jesus, but the Europeans translated and put that there. For now, this is what we believe in. But check out what the Most High said concerning the Gentiles.
Yo, Shabbat Shalom, everybody. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Let me get a good loud Shabbat Shalom, everybody.
Shabbat Shalom.
How everybody doing? All right, cool. Hey, before we even start, let's make sure to keep the background noise to a bare minimum. Please whisper if you do have to speak so we can have some order. Video is definitely being recorded, so we want to make sure that we can hear properly for the people that may check it out online. So make sure you keep the voices down to a bare minimum. Before we even get started, let me get a great hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Y'all suck, and guess what? It's recorded. Let me get a hallelujah to the top of your voices.
Hallelujah!
All right, man, praise the Most High's name. First and foremost, man, we want to acknowledge our sister. We met our sister a couple of weeks ago when we was dialoguing with the brothers from IUIC over there on Gratiot. So we want to acknowledge her sister. She finally came to join us. That boy Jerome wasn't answering the phone or whatever, so she didn't know how to get in touch with us. But she's here. Your sister was out there. Of course, as you know, as the show to see each other do, let's show her some love, and you know what I'm saying? The sister definitely know who she is. She know the Most High's name, so on and so forth. She was out there going back and forth with them brothers over the name and all that. Definitely displaying zeal. So show her some love. Sisters, make her feel welcome, so on and so forth. You know what I'm saying? The Most High is increasing us, all right? Second, we want to acknowledge our brother Sean right here. Another Israelite brother, know who he is for a while now. He came to join us from, where you reside at right now, brother? Right, from Bev, y'all, brother. We met him quite a while ago, about a year ago. Joshua brought the brother down. You remember the brother, right? Down there at the African-American Festival. Right. Our brother, I keep in touch with him on a regular. Want to acknowledge him as well. He here to join us and keep Shabbat. So, show the brother some love as well, right? All right. Now, today's topic, we're going to deal with, it's basically titled, Uplifting the Most High, Yahuwah's Name. And the inspiration for this is based on the fact that a lot of our people, first and foremost, when you come out, we coming out the church, there's two main strongholds that you got to deal with when you're coming out that church. I know personally, for me, it was that name Jesus or Jesus Christos, and that Sunday worship. Those are two of the main strongholds when you're coming out the church. Learning that the fact of the matter that His name ain't Jesus Christ, that was a hard pill to swallow. I joke with my brothers all the time about the fact that one of my favorite songs is that song by Lionel Richie called Jesus is Love. I ain't gonna front, Joy used to bring tears to my eyes, you know, because my grandparents instilled in me, hey, this was his name. And I uplifted that. I thought that that was the truth, you know what I'm saying? But it's complete fallacy, you know what I'm saying? So we're gonna deal with the name, because it's a very, very important thing. Let's pick this up at 2 Peter 1 and 12. Because again, in that Christian church, that name is being pushed throughout the entire earth. Everybody acknowledges it. They respect it. They say, well, we all got to bow the knee down to it. Not understanding that these people have played a major game with the scriptures. Now, the sad part is, you got brothers that's in the truth, that know who they are. Know they Israelites, been doing this thing for many of years. Know that that name ain't proper. But still going out there saying, hey, I come in the name of Jesus Christ. You know what I'm saying? And deceiving our people on a major level. 2 Peter 1 and 12.
2 Peter 1 and 12. Wherefore, I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things.
You see that? So, of course, we all know this. This, honestly, is the basics. It should be Hebrew 101 when you come out the, you know what I'm saying, the church or whatever false religion you caught up in. This should be the basics. But as Kiefer said right here, we're not going to be negligent to put you in remembrance of these things. Why? Because a lot of our people today are being deceived. They're being wholesale deceived by a lot of these brothers that sit in a high prominent role. Right? Read on.
Though you know them.
Though you know them. So we know the basics. You know what I'm saying? But we're going to cover them anyway. Just to have that in our remembrance and our spirit. So when we go out there and teach our people and share the full, unadulterated, raw truth, you can have these keys for you. Let's get 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 1. The book of 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I'm sorry, chapter 4 and verse 1. Pick it up when you got it. Huh?
2 Corinthians chapter 4 and 1. Therefore, seeing we have this mystery, ministry,
okay,
as we have received mercy, we faint not.
You see that? So we got that ministry. Us men starting off, you got the ministry of going out here and teaching the people the truth, serving the Most High and Hamashiach, right? Read on.
But we have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty.
So we renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. And one of the most dishonest things that the Gentiles have done is turn around and so-called translated or transliterated, whatever they call themselves doing, the name of the Most High and the Mashiach. That was dishonest. And we renounced that. But us being the true seed of the Most High, we're going to respect the Most High's name and the Mashiach's name. Read on.
Not walking in craftiness.
Not doing what?
No, not walking in craftiness.
Uh-huh.
Nor handling the word of Yahuwah deceitfully.
You see that? So unfortunately, these pastors, these leaders, these imams in the mosque, and unfortunately, these prominent Israelite leaders, they're being crafty with the word of the Most High. When you look at some of the things that have come out in the past couple of years, our brothers try to break down the name of the Most High and actually say, well, we don't know the name of the Most High. They being crafty and deceitful. Because the Most High say his, well, we're going to see what the Most High say in regards to his name. Drop that and let me get Proverbs 12 and verse 19. The book of Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 19. Swing that sword when you're ready, brother.
Proverbs 12 and 19. The lip of truth shall be established forever.
You see that? So when you walk in this truth and you speak the truth and respect the truth, your lips, those words that proceed out of your mouth, will stand forever. But let's see the other side of it. Read.
But a lying tongue is but for a moment.
So that lie that you speak, that these translators have spoken, and that our brothers that's in the world today want to keep uplifting, that's but for a moment. The Most High shined the light on that madness. And we, us being in the light, we're going to continue to walk in that and represent it with the lip of truth. Let's get Hebrews 13 and 15. Just laying a little foundation. Book of Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 15.
Hebrews chapter 13 and 15. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to Yahuwah continually.
You see that? So let's offer the sacrifice of praise. I remember when I was a young lad, man, we used to go to the church on Puritan in Wyoming. And one of the songs that they would sing when they was bringing forth to get ready to get them tithes about you was a song called "We Bring the Sacrifice of Praise." They used to sing that joint greatly, right? But it was in complete error. The Most High ain't hearing that message. Y'all singing to somebody else. But we gonna offer the sacrifice of praise, right? Finish that up.
That is the fruits of our lips.
Doing what?
Giving thanks to his name.
Giving thanks to his name. This is a key element when you read from cover to cover. The Most High's name is mentioned thousands of times. And it says give thanks to his name. So let's do this. Let's get a Most High the best round of applause that we can for his name. Again, let me get another hallelujah out here.
Hallelujah.
Exactly. Let's praise his name. We're going to represent his, the Most High's name at all times, right? Now let's get into the meat of this thing. Let's start with the basics. Let's go to Jubilees. If y'all got y'all Jubilees with you, let's start. Matter of fact, hold that. Get y'all some rock and turn to page 70. Go to your Apocrypha and let's go to page 70 real quick. Ecclesiasticus, in the beginning, we're going to look at the introduction. I want you to read, let me show you the paragraph. Okay, now when y'all look at, we're going to start at the introduction, okay? Okay. When y'all look at page 70, we're going to look at the prologue of the wisdom of Yahushua, the son of Sirach, okay? And then we're going to look down maybe three paragraphs. So it's going to pretty much be that last paragraph, but when you start reading, y'all be able to catch it up. Read that.
For the same things uttered in Hebrew.
You see that? So again, this is just the introduction to the book of Sirach. And he's getting ready to give you a backdrop about, you know what I'm saying, translating, so on and so forth. Read on.
For the same things uttered in Hebrew and translated into another tongue have not the same force in them.
You see that? So the things that's translated from our original tongue do not have the same force in them. The English, the Greek, the Latin, the Chinese, none of these languages have the same force of the Most High's word. Why is that? Let's see. Matter of fact, finish that up.
And not only these things, but the law itself.
You see that? The law itself. When you speak the law, in all reality, if you could begin to learn the tongue and speak it in the Hebrew, that's much more powerful than trying to say it in English or Greek. Right? And let's see why. Let's go to the book of Jubilees, chapter 12. And we're going to pick it up at the 25th verse. Y'all got y'all book of Jubilees? Open it up. If not, just write these scriptures down for your reference. Jubilees, chapter 12 and verse 25.
Jubilees 12 and 25. And Yahuwah Elohim said, open his mouth and his ears, that he may hear and speak with his mouth.
You see that? Now this is beginning. You read upper, it's talking about our great foreparent Abraham. The Most High that came to him and said, look here, brother, get up out of Babylon, right? Get up out of the place that I confounded all languages, right? Read on.
And Yahuwah Elohim said, open his mouth and his ears, that he may hear and speak with his mouth. With the language which have been revealed, for it has ceased from the mouths of all children of men.
You see that? So starting off, what does this show right here? The beginning language was the Hebrew. Straight up and down. That was the beginning language. Read on.
Children of men from the day of the overthrow.
You see, that's when the Most High overthrew Babel and confused the languages, he ceased that. He took the Hebrew away, but he did something great with our foreparents. Read on.
And I opened his mouth and his ears and his lips, and I began to speak with him in Hebrew.
In what?
In Hebrew.
You see that? He began to speak to him in Hebrew. Read on.
In the tongue of the creation.
In the tongue of what?
The tongue of the creation.
See that? So when the Mashiach was being instructed by the Most High to create everything, it was done by the Hebrew tongue. When the Most High speak, it's in the Hebrew tongue. Simple and plain. So I don't understand how any of y'all brothers can run out here and say, well, I'm just going to deal with the English. He speaks to me in stammering tongues. Totally misunderstanding Isaiah 28. Totally misunderstanding that. Right?
Exactly.
So get me Acts 26. Let's see if this thing continued all the way down to after when the Mashiach was put to death and rose again and went back to the Father. Let's see if this thing continued. Do the Hebrew tongue continue to be spoken? Let's see. Acts 26 and verse 13.
Acts chapter 26 and 13. At midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from Samaim.
So this is Shaul, a.k.a. Paul, speaking right here. He giving a recount to this Roman king right here when he got struck down by the Mashiach for all the wickedness he was doing amongst our people. But let's see what took place. Read on.
Above the brightness of the sun, shining round about me, them which journeyed with me, and when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue.
Saying what?
Saying in the Hebrew tongue.
Wait a minute. Now, when you study the book of Acts and you study Paul, that brother said, I speak many languages. When he was sitting there brought before that Roman governor and was getting ready to be, our people was getting ready to try to destroy him, he turned around and spoke to the Roman officer in Greek. And that man turned around and said, wait a minute, you want to speak Greek? Right. Ain't you that Egyptian? He was amazed that their brother knew various languages. But when he got this message right here from Shamaim, it spoke to him in what tongue?
Saying in the Hebrew tongue.
Uh-huh.
Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?
Uh-huh.
It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks.
Read.
And I said, who are you?
Now, he asked the question. Who are you? What is this? Who are you speaking to me from Shamaim in this vision? Who are you? Now he's going to be shown who it is. Read on.
And I said, who are you, master? And he says, I am Yahusha, whom thou persecutest.
You see that? So the Mashiach right here in all reality, if these people were being honest when they translated our scriptures, what should be here? The Hebrew. The Mashiach's true name. That should be there. It shouldn't be no Jesus Christos. It shouldn't be that. But they played that game with our scriptures. And you got a lot of our brothers running around here trying to uphold and uplift that. Continuing the deception. Right? Pass that mic to B. And B, I want you to give them the basic understanding of what a translation or transliteration is.
Basically, the difference between a translation and a transliteration is, let's take the word shalom, right? We all say shalom, right? And we use it as a greeting. But we all know shalom means what?
Peace.
It means peace. But we greet each other, shalom. But it translated into English, shalom means peace. But when we write shalom, how do we spell it?
S-H-A-L-O-M.
Right? S-H-A-L-O-M, right? That's how we write it. But that's a transliteration. Because in Hebrew, shalom is spelled Sheen, Lam, you know, it's spelled with Hebrew letters. But when you use English letters to write a word from another language, but you use the letters so that the sounds come out the exact same as it would in the original tongue, that's a transliteration, not a translation, right? Everybody following?
Right, well, you actually, on a basic level, you look at that term transliteration, it means transferring it literally into another language. It's simple. Right? So when you look at John 19, where Pilate wrote the Mashiach's name in what?
The Hebrew, the Latin,
the Greek, right? He would have used Greek and Latin words or lettering that would have reflected the Hebrew tongue. So when these Latin and Greek speaking people seen the name, they would have been able to pronounce his proper name. Correct?
วันนี้เวลา 16:53 นาทีพระบาทสมเด็จพระเจ้าอยู่หัวเสด็จออกหน้าห้องประชุมสมเด็จพระเจ้าพี่นางเธอกรมหลวงนราธิวาสราชนครินทร์ชั้น14อาคารเฉลิมพระเกียรติโรงพยาบาลสิริราชส่งรับนายบารักโอบามา The Honorable Barack Obama ประธานาธิบดีแห่งสหรัฐอเมริกาและคณะในโอกาสเดินทางเยือนประเทศไทยอย่าง
It wouldn't have been around here pushing and preaching, which is a deception, right? So, let's deal with just the basics. I'm going to take this. We all know, again, like Keeper said, I'm going to put you in remembrance of it, but we all know the history on the letter J, right? Let's just read it anyway. We're going to take this out of a book called Understand. Now, who is this guy, Nathaniel Ben Israel? Well, he's a prominent leader in the nation of Israel today. The camp IUIC, that's who he heads. His brother has been in the truth for, honestly, almost past decades probably now. So he's a man of learning, he's a man of understanding, right? But, unfortunately, things have started to change with the brother in these last days. But, let's see some of what he wrote concerning the history on the letter J. Read, oh yes, page 4.
This is page 4 of their brother's book. The letter J was created in the 1700s.
You see that? So that's basic history. We know that. It was created by a Roman Catholic, a Jesuit. That's who put that together. Experiment with the I. That's what it is. J is the derivative of the letter I. That's all it is, right? Read on.
The King James Version Bible, 1611, had no J in it, in its text, and included the 14 books of the Apocrypha. King James Version today have actually been revised since 1769 and do not include the Apocrypha.
You see that? So they took the Apocrypha out, but what they actually did when they revised it, they inserted the J. So when you actually go into your 1611, there are no letter J's. So again, the Mashiach was called something totally different over 400 years ago. So where these brothers get that from? How can you uphold a falsehood? Turn to the next page. Now, unfortunately, like I said, this brother right here, he's a prominent brother in the nation of Israel. He's doing a lot of works around this place, so on and so forth. But now, he's starting to teach things that's honestly unprofitable and wicked, according to scripture. It's a sad thing, but that's just the case. Now, read what he says right here concerning. Hold that up and show them what that says. Because unfortunately, the brother said, hey, we ain't got, nobody knows the name. What'd that say? Read that top portion. I know it's kind of raggedy.
It says, the true name.
The what?
The true name.
You see that? With the yod hey wah hey. Right? In the paleo. He got it right there, right? Read on.
Today's common name, Jehovah, was derived from YHWH.
Uh-huh. So again, when you get to studying any type of reference, they'll let you know that term Jehovah was a composite of the term Adonai and the Tetragrammaton. So that's a complete falsehood. Even Kenneth Copeland came out and said Jehovah wasn't right. And we know how wicked that cat is.
That is the personal name of himself. That is the name. That is the name. It was revealed to Moses. The Father said it to Moses personally. That was the first time he had spoken it in the earth. You remember he said, and in fact it's been brought out this week, that he said to Moses, they have known me as El Shaddai, but they are about to know me as, and he said his name. We have very lamely translated it Jehovah, which in the English language doesn't have any meaning.
Brother, 33rd degree Freemason, wicked is all outdoors. But he admitted that to his congregation, right? That's good enough right there. That's it, the true name, right?
Yep.
We ain't even got to read no more right there. Got them four letters, right?
Four letters.
Okay. That's good. Now, let's show some. It's going to the Smith's Bible Dictionary. We're gonna hit a couple of different books and, you know what I'm saying, go back and forth in these precepts, but just touch a little history. Just to, you know, have ourselves fully established in this truth. So I want you to read the definition for Jesus. That name that these people adore. Read that right there. Just that particular highlight.
Okay. Jesus. Greek and Latin of Hebrew, Joshua.
Of Hebrew what?
Of Hebrew, Joshua.
You see that? It's Latin and Greek. The Mashiach did not come from no lineage of no Greeks or no Romans. He was a Hebrew. That's plain and simple. So why in the world would Miriam and Yosef name their son after the Greeks? That makes absolutely no sense. But as we're going to see later on, when that Malachim came from Shamayim, he told them what to name him. And again, we see it was established that the Hebrew tongue is spoken in Shamayim, right? Correct?
Correct.
Okay. Let's read another particular definition. This is coming out of the Varsity Bible Dictionary. Page 444. This is dealing with the letter J, just for confirmation. Read the highlighted section, brother.
This is dealing with, like you said, the actually, all the names which begin with J in our English Bibles were pronounced in the original language with a Y sound.
With a what?
With a Y sound.
Exactly. So anytime you, again, going back, that I, when it was transliterated, carried the Y sound. It's simple. But why all of a sudden today it turned around and changed? What's going on here? Deception at its finest. And our people is being deceived by that. Because when we continue, we're going to see knowing this name is very, very key. Now, let's touch it.
Let me finish this.
Okay, go ahead and finish that up.
So it was pronounced in the original language with the Y sound, as in hallelujah.
As in what?
Hallelujah.
Okay, that's cool. Yeah, that's exactly how they have it written in the so-called new covenant. All right. Now, with that term Christos or Christ, let's read a little bit of history concerning that, because that. Simple and plain, the term Messiah, like what he read right there, when we read out of the particular dictionary, it said that it's the Greek form or the Latin form of Joshua. So if these people want to deal with a translation, it should really be Joshua the Messiah. It should not be Jesus Christ. You know what I'm saying? And we're going to see why they end up trying to play that particular game. It should be Joshua the Messiah, because Messiah is actually the transliteration coming from the Latin and the Greek. That form of Mashiach. You know what I'm saying? So that term Christos comes from something else. It's actually dealing with pagan deities, right?
Yes.
Now, we're going to read a testimony from Hadrian, the Roman emperor, in the 2nd century B.C. with his correspondence between this brother named Servanius. Read this particular setup right here. Read it like loud and clear right there. That whole highlighted section. Check this out. For our peoples that want to continue calling themselves and they camps under Christos or Christ, check out what this says right here.
It says, Hadrian to Servanius, Egypt, which you commended to me, my desert, my dearest Servanius, I have found to be wholly fickle and inconsistent and continually wafted about every breath of fame. The worshippers of Serapis.
Of who?
Of Serapis.
The worshippers of Serapis. You do any mythological background check on this cat, and it was a composite of it. The Egyptian did. When these Greeks came in and took over Egypt, they took Zeus, Dionysius, all these other gods, and combined him with the Apis bull. And this is how they formed Serapis. But he took.
My memories of yesterday. Day.
96 gon' be that.
with no game. Told the truth to get what I want, but shot it with no shame. Take this music dead serious while others entertain. I see they making they paper, so I guess I can't complain. Or can I? I feel they disrespecting the whole thing. Them hoax like selling dope to black folks.
Or the complete form of Zeus. Okay, that's who Sir Rapist is. That's what, but he was called Sir Rapist Christus. Right? The anointed one, the anointed bull of Apis, or the anointed Zeus. Right? Read on.
The worshippers of Sir Rapist here are called Christians.
Which you commended to me, my dearest Servanius, I have found to be wholly fickle and inconsistent, and continually wafted about the early breath of fame. The worshippers of Sir Rapist here are called Christians.
They're called what?
Called Christians.
You see that? So those that was worshiping that pagan deity were called Christians. Right? And what else do we say, brother?
And those who are devoted to the god Sir Rapist, I find, call themselves Bishop of Christ.
They call themselves what?
Bishops of Christ.
You see that? So what in the world is going on here? How can we be men of the Most High, taking on Hebrew names, walking in our culture that the Most High has restored to us? How can we run around calling ourselves bishops of Christ when this thing goes back to pagan deities? Read that particular portion right there that's highlighted. Yeah.
Nothing new under the sun.
Yeah, there's nothing new under the sun.
The term Christ and Christians, spelt originally Christ and Christians, were borrowed from the temple vocabulary of the pagans. Were borrowed from the temple vocabulary of the pagans.
You see that? So again, that term Christos goes back to paganism. Has nothing to do with the Mashiach. If they was going to be dealing with any type of term from the Latin or the Greek, it would be Messiah. Simple and plain. That's just quoting the basic history right there. All right? Let's get back into these scriptures. There's a lot of brothers say, hey, don't nobody know the name. The name just came to Moses. Is that true? According to scripture?
No.
Absolutely not. Let's pick it up at Genesis chapter 4 and verse 26. Matter of fact, read this right here. Read that highlighted section right here. This is a sneak peek on what Josephus had to say about these Greeks and what they love to do. Yeah.
It says, and they were the Greeks who became the authors of such mutations.
Authors of what?
Of such mutations.
So the Greeks, they're known for mutating something. They're known for coming in and taking over cultures. You know what I'm saying? Read on.
For when in after ages they grew potent, they claimed to themselves the glory of antiquity, giving names to the nations that sounded well in Greek.
In Greek, you see that? So when they come in and take over a nation, what do? They dispel the name that was already there, and they place their name there. This is why Ethiopia is called Ethiopia. From Ethiops, it's Greek, meaning burnt face. Mesopotamia, so on and so forth. These people come in, they take over, and then they put their names there. And they did the same thing with the Mashiach and us. This is why you have brothers running around calling themselves Demetrius, Lionysius. You know, in all reality, let's be honest, our brothers that want to uphold this Hebrew and Greek, they might as well take that on, right?
Exactly.
Call yourself Dionysius the Hebrew. In all reality, you want to uphold the Greek and Latin tongue, why take on a Hebrew name and then uplift that language?
So we just going to start calling them Themistocles and stuff like this.
Exactly. That's what they love, right? That was, I'll get it to you on the side. Gotta break that down. Read 2 Maccabees chapter 4 and verse 15. See, these Greeks come in, they take over the scene, put their names there, and that's what they did with the Mashiach, right? Our people love that, according to the scriptures. Read that.
2 Maccabees chapter 4 and verse 15. Not setting by the honors of their fathers, but liking...
Not what?
Not setting by the honors of their fathers.
See, our great foreparent inherited what? The Hebrew language. But when even during the Maccabean period, when these Greeks came in, a lot of our people turned cult. They turned sellout and got on the Greek side. They didn't want to uphold what was given to their fathers, right? And do what?
But liking the glory of the Grecians best of all.
You see that? And unfortunately, that's what we see today in a lot of our brothers. They love the Greek, English, Roman way of life, that European way of life, and uphold it tooth and nail. Sad thing. But let's see if the name goes back to the beginning. Genesis 4 and 26. 2 Maccabees
was 4 and 15.
4 and 15. Genesis chapter 4 and verse 26. Everybody good?
Genesis 4 and 26. And to Seth, to him also there was born a son, and he called his name Enos. Then began men to call upon the name of Yahuwah.
Of what?
Then began men to call upon the name of Yahuwah.
What's that down? What is being spoken of right here?
This right here is actually, this is when they first started to profane his name. So when you go into this word that's began, it means to profane. And this is, they knew his name, but this is where they started to actually profane it while calling it.
Exactly. And by their wicked works, they started to profane the name of the Most High, making up idols and calling them idols by the Most High's name, so on and so forth. This is when they begin to do this thing. Showing you all the way from Adam all the way down, they knew the name of the Most High. Some say, well, Abraham didn't know it, right? They want to go to that, what is it, Exodus 6? And twist that scripture up. But let's see if Abraham knew the name of the Most High. Genesis 22 and verse 13. The book of Genesis chapter 22 and verse 13.
He said Abraham was his friend.
Yeah, how can I call you my brother and my friend and I don't know your name? I just say, hey, you popular guy on Facebook. You would, you know, you cat that like to be cool all the time and wave your hands when you dance. How would you look at me and say, yeah, that's my friend? No, I know your name, right?
Exactly.
Genesis 22 and 13.
Genesis.
That's all good. It's all good. Slight error. It's all good. Genesis 22 and verse 13.
Genesis 22, 13. And Abram lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abram went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son.
Now check out what Abraham does. Read on.
And Abraham called the name of that place.
So where they was at, where the Most High came through and provided that sacrifice instead of just when he was testing our forebear, he provided that sacrifice so Isaac didn't have to be put to death. Seeing how faithful Abraham was, right? But he gonna turn around, he names this place something. Read on.
And Abram called the name of that place Yahuwah Jireh, as it said to this day, in the mount of Yahuwah it shall be seen.
You see that? That Yahuwah Jireh means Yahuwah will see. So why would he name, if he didn't know the name, how did he name this place that? He knew the name of the Most High. Simple and plain. So how can men come and say, well, look, that's just a title. We just know titles of the Most High. No, it says name. They knew, our foreparents knew the name of the Most High. So when you read the book of Jasher, when Moses received that staff, you can read this in Jasher 77. The name of the Most High was inscribed on it. That same staff that he went before Pharaoh with, the Most High's name was inscribed, and it was handed down from Adam all the way down. So the name of the Most High has been traveling throughout all generations. We're going to see that by the scriptures. Now let's take a look at the historical changing of our images and names according to scripture. Let's get 1 Maccabees 3 and 45. Book of 1 Maccabees chapter 3 and verse 45. Let me get this up to where. Because when these Europeans came on the scene, they did a great work to our people. A very mischievous, wicked work to us. To make us, the Most High was using them without question because of our wickedness. But they went out their way. 1 Maccabees 3 and verse 45.
1 Maccabees 3 and 45. Now Jerusalem lay void as a wilderness. There was none of her children that went in or out.
You see that? So again, this during the Maccabean period, the Most High brought swift destruction upon us for our wickedness and not keeping the commandments. So our land lay desolate. Read on.
The sanctuary also was trodden down, and aliens kept the stronghold.
See that? Foreigners came in and kept the stronghold. The scriptures call them aliens, right? Just like how these people try to play as the so-called immigrants today that was originally here. Call them aliens and illegal immigrants and all that foolishness. We had that same thing going on in our land. Read on.
The heathens had their habitation in that place, and joy was taken from Jacob, and the pipe with the harp ceased. Wherefore, the Israelites assembled themselves together and came to Mizpah, over against Jerusalem. For in Mizpah was the place where they prayed aforetime in Israel.
Drop down to the 48th verse.
Verse 48. And laid open the book of the law.
So they got the law, the scriptures, the Torah, right? They got their hands back on it, which the Greeks then came in, tried to burn up. Antiochus Epiphanes with his wicked behind came in there and tried to destroy the Most High's Torah and so on. So we could be disconnected from the Most High. But they got the book and did what?
And laid open the book of the law wherein the heathens had sought to paint the likeness of their images.
You see that? And these people do this to this day. Even to this day, you go purchase you a good set of scriptures and what it got in there. That image is Zeus. Jesus Christos or Caesar Borgia. Got that sitting right there in the scriptures. So they historically known for coming in and take, they put up that image. But let's see. Let's see what they do with the names. Let's get Daniel 4 and 8. They don't have no problem putting up a fake image. You know what I'm saying? The sad thing is you got some of my brothers running around here putting up images of what they say the Mashiach look like. And we're forbidden to do that according to scriptures. Deuteronomy 4 shows you you're not supposed to do that.
It's not the image, it's just a image.
That's wicked, brother. The Most High ain't allowed that. And our people is caught up in all manners of sin. We talking about Israelites awake. Daniel 4 and 8. Let's see what these people, our adversaries, are notorious for doing.
Daniel 4 and 8. But at last, Daniel came in before me, whose name was Belteshazzar, according to the names of my power.
No, read that flat.
But at last, Daniel came in before me, whose name was Belteshazzar, according to the name of my God.
According to the name of his God. You know why? Because Nebuchadnezzar took them strong brothers and did what? You ain't going to be Mishael. You ain't going to be Hananiah no more. You ain't going to be Daniel no more. I'm going to give you a name according to my God. So that Belteshazzar means, unfortunately, a prince of Baal or Baal. That's what his name was changed to. And they notorious in doing that. And that's exactly what they did to the Mashiach's name. Matter of fact, let's get proof of that. Get that Luke 4 and 27 in the 16:11. Matter of fact, I'm going to pass this around. Pass it around to the people. Read Luke 4 and 27 for me. Look at the highlighted section on that pass off right there. See that? You see a striking position right there? Yeah.
The book of Luke, chapter 4, verse 27. And many lepers were in Israel at the time of Elizeus.
What?
Elizeus.
At the time of Elizeus, right? Now just finish that out. Let's see who this is actually talking about.
In another century, the magnificent temple had disappeared from history. But in a curious way, the likeness of Zeus may still survive today. Many art historians believe that the facial features of the statue were used as a model for images of Jesus.
Prophet, and none of them was cleansed, saving Naaman the Syrian.
So who, according to our historical accounts, who is this talking about? Can anybody tell me? Huh? It's Elisha, the one who came after Eliyah. It was the one, you know what I'm saying, the one that said, give me that double portion, right? That's who that was. And his name in the Hebrew means Elohim is salvation. But what these Greeks turn around and do, when they translated it, when you really break that down, what do that mean? Exactly. Zeus is my God. So that's what they had the nerve to insert into the scriptures. Now, I know a lot of our brothers, we go into the dialects, and, you know, you look at the name, hey, Zeus, that's directly going back to Zeus. But we see what these people doing. We know that the chief deity of the Greeks and Romans was Zeus. Then translated and keeping that same custom going. And this is what our people actually is putting up. And they don't even realize that. Let's look at the conspiracy
of our foreparents.
Of our foreparents with the name of the Most High.
Let's go to Jeremiah 23 and verse 1. Can everybody hear me loud and clear? I know that. Can you hear me speaking to you? She gonna answer me. No. Can you hear me, Sister Ruth? I'm just, I'm messing with you. Can you hear me, though?
Yeah, I can
hear you. All right. So what you was quick to say no for then? Okay. As long as y'all can hear me in the back, that's cool.
Back on? Can you hear me now?
Yeah, much better.
All right. All right. Huh? I know, that's why we throw the mic in anyway. Jeremiah 23 and 1.
Jeremiah 23 and 1. Woe be unto the pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep of my pastor, saith the Lord.
See that? Now the Most High is putting out an indictment against those leaders and pastors in Israel. Now a lot of times, you know, we apply this, and it's applicable as well to the Christian pastors. But guess what's going on in these last days? You got men amongst Israel that know they Israel, and then they're scattering the flock. They want to separate their camp from the other body of the Mashiach and say, well, we ain't dealing with nobody else. We are those guys. The Mosiah is dealing with us. But is that how it's supposed to be? Absolutely not. But it says, woe to those pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep of my flock. Right? Drop down to verse 27.
Verse 27.
Matter of fact, pick it up at 26.
Verse 26, Jeremiah 23 and 26. How long shall this be in the heart of the prophets that prophesy lies?
It's a lie to say that we don't have the name of the Most High. It's a lie to run around and teach our people in the name of AKA Jesus Christos. Jesus Christ, that's a lie. We should be edifying our people according to the truth. Our heritage, the Mashiach's true name. Read on.
Yea, they are prophets of deceit of their own hearts.
So these people, these brothers doing this thing out their own heart. Not according to the historical account of the scriptures, but their own hearts. Drop down to verse 27.
Which think to cause my people to forget my name.
Which the what?
Which think to cause my people to forget my name.
And that's what these brothers doing. They causing our people to forget the name and uphold the name of these Greeks and Romans. The implanted name that they put there. Read on.
Which think to cause my people to forget my name by their dreams, which they shall tell every man to his neighbor, as their fathers have forgotten my name for Baal.
For what?
For Baal.
As that we, our fathers forgot the name of the Most High for Baal. So they start calling on who? The Lord. Because that's what Baal goes back to. So these brothers run around here talking about, I believe in the Lord. All praise to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's Baal. Jesus Christos goes back to sun worship. Straight up Baalism. That ain't got nothing to do with the Most High, the true living Mashiach. So what's wrong with our brothers? Why do you want to uphold that? Makes no sense. Let's get Acts 4 and verse 13. Let's look at this conspiracy continuing on through a lot of the leaders back in the day when the Mashiach was on the scene. Actually, after he had left. Acts 4 and verse 13.
Acts chapter 4 and 13. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. They marveled. You see that?
So Kefa and Yahuqanan come on the scene and they dropping the word heavy on them brothers that were sitting in what? In leadership, right? And they said, these brothers is unlearned.
Some of the ignorant.
And guess what? Some of these elders, unfortunately, not all, some of them sitting that same thing and they look at us and say, man, you've been in the truth 7-8 years. You're unlearned. Don't listen to them. That's what they say. But they said the same thing about these brothers right here, right? Read on.
And they took knowledge of them that they had been with Yahusha.
Uh-huh. Drop down to verse 15.
Verse 15. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, what shall we do to these men?
Uh-huh.
For that indeed a notable miracle has been done by them is manifested to all them that dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it.
So they had healed that brother in the name, the true and living name, not a title, but the name of the Mashiach. And they said, you know what? This thing, we got to stop this right here. A notable thing has been done by these brothers, right? Read on.
But that it spread no further among the people, let us straightly threaten them that they speak henceforth no more in this name.
You see that? So we see the conspiracy of our foreparents, not going our people to deal with the true name of the Most High going on from ancient times all the way down to even the Mashiach, even present day. Unfortunately, these brothers keeping up that same conspiracy. Drop over to chapter 5 and verse 27. Okay, read that.
Verse 18. And they called them and commanded them not to speak at all nor teach in the name of Yahusha.
You see that? So they commanded them, don't even teach in that name. And guess what? These brothers telling us the same thing. You run around talking about Hebrew, this, that, whatever. You ain't supposed to do that. Ain't that what our brother trying to say? The Most High has commanded us to teach in his name. Right? Drop over to chapter 5 and verse 27.
Acts 5 and 27. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council, and the high priest asked them, saying, did not we straightly command you that you should not teach in this name?
See that? So they commanded them, but what the brothers do? They ain't listen. But they're going to continue to uplift the Most High and the Mashiach's name in truth and righteousness. Read on.
And wait a minute. Saying, did not we straightly command you that you should not teach in this name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intended to bring this man's blood upon us.
You see that? Our foreparents was responsible for the blood that fell from the Mashiach. So you was responsible for that, but they want to get away from the name, right? Drop down. Read with Kefa total. Verse 29.
Verse 29. Then Kefa and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey the Most High rather than men.
That's the spirit that a true Hebrew Israelite is supposed to walk on. We ain't going to obey men. We're going to uplift the Most High's name and the Mashiach's name. No matter what, we're going to teach in that name. Not this bastard tongue given to us by these Romans and Greeks. Give me Jeremiah 2 and verse 33. Let's see what the Most High had to say about our forefathers. Because again, we look at these Romans and Greeks and we say, hey, yeah, they translated it. They did very good wickedness to it. But it started with our foreparents, as we clearly read right there. Jeremiah 2 and verse 33.
Jeremiah 2 and 33. Why trimmest thou the way to seek love?
Uh-huh.
Therefore hast thou also taught the wicked ones thy ways?
You see that? We taught the wicked our ways. So because we want to not deal with the Most High and take his name away, want to deal with our own, we taught the wicked ones their way. Our way, rather. And now these people have come in while we're placing this captivity and have taught us to worship our own. But it started with us. We done taught the wicked our way. So we're more wicked than the wicked. And our people continue to uplift that. What's wrong with us, man? What's wrong with us, huh?
Backwards.
Now you have in certain circles, like some of the brothers that call on Ohio. They go into the name and they speak wickedly against what's known as the Tetragrammaton, the four letters that compose the Most High's name. And one of the a part of their doctrine is, well, Yah or Yahuwah is Satan or the moon god. That's fallacy. That's complete wickedness. I mean, and unfortunately, the brothers got a lot of blood on their hands for speaking that. They better repent before it's too late. Let's get Jasher 79 and pick it up at the 41st verse. Let's see if Yahuwah is a moon god. Because, A.B., you specialize in the feast days. Why is it that when the nations, because the scriptures say the Most High's name is dreadful to the other nations. Why is that? What was going on when we came out of Passover? Get out the mic. What was the people seeing that would make them attribute, because they love worshiping idols. What was going on, brother?
On the night that the last plague came down and the firstborn sons were all killed in the whole land of Egypt, it was the middle of the month, so it was a full moon out.
It was what?
A full moon.
A full moon. Right?
Right. So when this happened in the middle of the night and they came out, they saw this full bright moon, and you know, it's very, very, well, I mean, they could have, you know, derived that or became fearful of the moon, you know, saying, oh, well, this Yahuwah must be a moon god because of that.
Exactly, and that's what actually took place. A full moon was going on, and we know these people worship the sun, the moon, and the stars. So when the Most High dropped that plague down on Egypt and destroyed them, all those pagans thought, oh my goodness, he got that. The deity of the moon is doing this. That's how that got applied. So how can they turn around and say, well, Yahuwah is a moon god? Absolutely not. Let's see. Let's see if he an Egyptian moon god according to the scriptures. Jasher 79 and 41. Pick it up right there.
The book of Jasher 79 and verse 41. And Aaron hastened and stretched forth his hand and caught hold of the serpent's tail, and it became a rod in his hand.
So we know the story. Moshe and Aharon go before Pharaoh. They dropped that rod down. It was getting busy, right? And then that Pharaoh turned around and was like, wait a minute, these brothers got some problems, right? But they wanted to see, he wanted to see something. Drop down to verse 43.
Verse 43.
Keep it in mind, Moshe got the name from the Most High when he spoke at the so-called burning bush, right? Wasn't the name given?
Yep.
Read that.
And when the king saw this thing, he ordered the book of records that related to the kings of Egypt to be brought. And they brought the book of records, the chronicles of the king of Egypt, in which all the idols of Egypt were inscribed.
You see that? So again, now, if Yahuwah is a moon deity, we should be able to see his name in these records. Because the Pharaoh, they record all of their deities. These people was meticulous about that. Is that, are we going to find his name? Let's see. Read.
But they thought of finding therein the name of Yahuwah, but they found it not.
They didn't find the name of the Most High written within the Egyptian pantheon. Because Yahuwah ain't no moon god. He's the great creator of the entire universe. Simple. So how can these brothers, these brothers are learned. They know these things is here. They deceitfully not pushing this out here. Because they have an agenda. And that's a sad thing. That's cool right there. We commanded to respect the Most High's name. Let's get Exodus 20 and 8. Let's look at something real quick. Because again, even in Egyptology, under the so-called laws of Ma'at, they have 42 laws written in that. And they'll say, well, you know, the Bible is plagiarized. It comes from Egypt, so on and so forth. But that's a lie. There's key elements that's written within the law that show you that the law is set apart. Pick it up at the 8th verse. Let's look at the Shabbat. Let's look at something what the Most High did with his name. Exodus 20 and 8.
Shemur 20 and 8. Remember the Sabbath to keep it kodesh.
You see that? So we command it to keep the Shabbat, right? Now drop down to verse 11.
Verse 11. For in 6 days Yahuwah made Shamayim and the earth.
Now stop right there. Now what I got right here, anybody know what this is? Right. The seal of the President of the United States, right? Do y'all know what this is used for? Huh? To do what? Exactly. Whenever a law or an official document is put into place, for example, like Barack Obama, when he put down all his wicked legislation, he gonna put his name down, Barack Obama, and then seal it with this. So it's gonna have his name, his title, or what he reigns over, which is the being the position he holds, being the President of the United States, and his jurisdiction, which is the United States, right? So what did the Most High actually do with his name in verse 11? He actually did the same thing. Read the top verse.
For in 6 days, Yahuwah made Shamayim and the earth.
You see that? So the Most High's name right there, Yahuwah made Shamayim and the earth. His name is there and it shows his jurisdiction. So he actually sealed the actual commandments right there. He signed it. Don't have no other deities, no graven images, right? Don't take my name in vain, and then the Shabbat, and signs his name sealed right there. The name of the Most High is important. How these brothers don't see that? Makes no sense. Let's get Jeremiah 3 and 14. Because as B broke down when we went through the commandments, he went into Exodus, the 20th chapter, dealing with the name of the Most High. He brought out something very profound. Jeremiah 3 and verse 14.
Jeremiah 3 and 14. Turn, O backsliding children, saith Yahuwah, for I am married unto you.
Exactly. So when you get married, what do the woman do?
Takes his name.
You take the name of the man. So the Most High, matter of fact, get number 6 and verse 7. He said he's married to us, right? Read that number 6 and 7.
Numbers chapter 6, verse 7. He shall not make himself unclean for his father. Okay, or for his mother.
Hold on, I'm sorry. I wrote that down wrong. Drop down to verse 27. My apologies.
Verse 27, six and 27. And they shall put my name upon the children of Israel. I will increase them.
You see that? So the Most High married us and put his name upon us. So that means we took on that covenant, we take on the name of the Most High, meaning we represent Yahuwah, period. So how can brothers come and teach something totally different, right? Let's go back to Exodus 20 and 7. So with that understanding, knowing that we married to the Most High, that we take on his name, he gives us a clear and distinct warning. Exodus 20 and verse 7.
Exodus 20 and verse 7. Thou shalt not take the name of Yahuwah thy power in vain.
You see that? So we commanded. How can we wake up in these last days? Learn the laws. Learn the commandments. Learn about walking with the Mashiach. And then turn around and say, well, I ain't going to deal with the name. That's a title or whatever. Nobody has the name. How can we say that? He said, don't take the name of the Most High in vain. Right? And what does that mean? The term take can also be, it's H5375. Some of the definitions for it is bring forth, or carry away, or cast. That's some of the basic definitions for it. And then the term vain is H7723. Means to desolate, to ruin, or uselessness, make it useless. So he said, don't take my name in vain. That's a very important thing. If we run around here talking about we the children of Israel, we got to represent. Take his name in vain. That's a clear violation of the Most High's law. A clear violation. Anything you got? Anything you want to add? B. Let's get Leviticus 24 and 16. We got to repent of this stuff, and those of us that hold dear to the name continue to do so till it's over. To the wheels fall off. Leviticus 24 and 16.
Leviticus 24 and 16. And he that blasphemes the name of Yahuwah, he shall surely be put to death.
You see that? So run around talking about the Most High's name ain't nothing. We can do whatever with it. I ain't going to call him by that title. That's actually blasphemy. Because they look up H53:54. B, look it up for me real quick. I know you love that Hebrew. H53:44. Yes. Y'all write that down for your notes. Go take a look at it when you get a chance. H53:44. Exactly. Right. That's crazy.
H53:44. Nakab. To puncture.
To do what?
To puncture.
How do you puncture something? You put holes in it, right? You run around and say, well, that's just a title. It's not there. It don't exist. Y'all arguing over how to pronounce it. You punch holes in the Mosai's name. Puncture. That mean it also means to do what? Ruin or do violence to, right? Read on.
Literally, to perforate.
To what?
To perforate.
To perforate. Anybody know the definition for perforate? To do what? Exactly. Read that for the people, the highlighted section. This is the definition for perforate. So again, this goes back to blaspheming the name of the Most High.
Perforate. To bore or punch a hole in.
Speaking of the microphone.
Perforate. To bore or punch a hole in. Pierce. To make rows of holes. In for easy separation.
You see that? So to make holes in for easy separation. So go in and try to twist up the scriptures so we can separate the children of Israel from the Most High's name. But that's wicked as all outdoors.
And to pierce. Who did they? Somebody did that to him, right?
Yeah. Huh. To pierce? The Mashiach, right?
Yeah.
Right. Right. They got the preparation line, right? And that's what a lot of these brothers doing. They blaspheme in the name of the Most High with that. Trying to separate us from the Most High's name. That's wicked, man. Get Deuteronomy 28:58. The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 and verse 58. Again, we dealing with the Torah right here, right? It's the law, right? Ain't this the law, y'all?
Yes.
This is the light of life, right?
Yes.
Commandments? Doctrine of life?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Let's see what the Most High says. Deuteronomy 28 and verse 58.
Deuteronomy 28 and 58. If thou wilt not observe to do all the words of this law.
So we got
to
do all the words of the Most High law. Not just, oh, I ain't going to deal with the name. The name is within the law. Simple and plain. He sealed the law with his name. Period. Right? Read on.
If thou wilt not observe to do all the words of this law that are written in this book, that thou mayest fear the glorious and fearful name.
That you may do what?
That mayest fear this glorious and fearful name.
You see that? We're supposed to fear the Most High's name. Finish that out.
Yahuwah, thy power.
You see that? It says fear this highly esteemed, a.k.a. glorious name. That's what we're supposed to do, man. Okay, read that. Nice and clear.
This is from the Hallelujah Scriptures. If you do not guard to do all the words of this Torah.
Read that again.
If you do not guard to do all the words of this Torah that are written in this book to revere this esteemed and awesome name, Yahuwah, your Elohim.
You see that? So, B, get the definition for Shem or name. What is that? What does that mean? Read the definition for the people. The Most High commands us to fear his name. Not turn around and say, well, you can call him whatever you want. We don't have the name anymore. I can translate it. That's falsehood. Read that definition for me, brother.
H-80-34.
Okay.
H-80-34, shame, name, reputation, fame, esteem, the name as designation of the Most High, memorial, or monument.
You see that? So the Most High's name is his monument, his memorial. Exodus 3 and 15, when he gave the name, he said, this is my memorial to all what? All generations. For how long, B?
Forever.
Forever. Not to be cut off when we go into captivity. Forever. You got something you want to add? Exactly. That's why. Exactly why they beat the name out of us. Exactly.
That's when everything popped up. We cry out to the
name. Let's see how important the Most High's name is for salvation. Because I heard some of these brothers say, "Well, man, y'all talk about the name is for salvation. It ain't. That's not true." But let's see what the scripture says. Let's go to Matthew 1 and 21. The book of Matit Yahu. Wait a minute. Matthew had a Hebrew name? His name, it had to be Matthew, right?
Surely, because it's in here.
Yeah, nah, brother. He had a Hebrew name. Matthew 1 and 21. Matter of fact, pick it up at verse 20.
Matit Yahu 1 and 20. But while he taught on these things, behold, the Malachim of Yahuwah appeared unto him in a dream, saying.
Now we know again, the language is in Shamaim. So all the righteous Malachim speak it. The Mashiach spoke it when he came down dealing with Shaul. So on and so forth. Read on.
Saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Miriam thy wife. For that which is conceived in her is of the Ruach HaKodesh. And she said, she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Yahusha.
You see that? So he said, you shall call his name. Did that say title?
His name.
It says, call his name. Give him a memorial. Give something to identify him, right? Call him what?
So call his name Yahusha.
Why is that?
For he shall save his people from their sin.
You see that? So the Mashiach's name represents his duty. What he was sent down here to do for the nation of Israel and those that would like to join on to the house. So what are these brothers talking about? He came to be Yahuwah's salvation. That should be Hebrew 101. But there's a lot of deception going forth in this earth. Orchestrated by HaShaitan. Simple and plain. Let's get John 5 and 43.
Them brothers got Hebrew
names. Exactly. I want to deal with the Greek. Complete matters. John 5 and 43.
Yehukanan 5 and 43. I am come in my Father's name.
You see that? Mashiach, he's going to say this continuously. But he said, I come in my Father's name. When you got a firstborn son, what's the thing you want to do? How you going to name him?
Junior.
A what? Right. You're going to name, matter of fact, my slave name is Thomas Jefferson Murphy III. Yeah, it's terrible, I know. But I come from the lineage from my foreparents that say, hey, we're going to name our son Thomas. My grandfather was Thomas I. All the way down to me. Yeah, I know it sucks. That's why I took my Hebrew name on, according to what? Isaiah 44 and what? And 5. Right. Got about that slave master name, right? But he said, I come in my Father's name, right? And you do what?
And you receive me not.
You see that? A lot of people don't want to receive. He come in the Father's name, but you want to receive Jesus Christos, right? But what else he going to say? Read.
If another shall come in his own name, him you will receive.
And that's exactly what HaShaitan has done. He's come in the name of Jesus Christos, Allah, Buddha, all these other names that they didn't put in the earth. That's who he come in. And what are people doing? They receive it just like the Mashiach said. Making no separation. And that's wicked in the sight of the Most High and the Mashiach. That's no respect for the Father. Get me Hebrews 2 and 11. The book of Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 11. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 11.
Hebrews chapter 2 and 11. For both he that sanctified, they who are sanctified are all one.
You see that? So when you become truly set apart or sanctified, that means that you are set apart, right? What's another term for set apart?
Kadesh.
Huh?
Kadesh.
Right, Kadesh. A.K.A. holy. Also hallowed, right? Wait a minute. The Mashiach's prayer said, our Father, who art in Shamayim, hallowed be your name, right? Hallowed be your name. Sanctified be your... Good grief.
Yes.
Drop down to verse 12. Say it again, brother. Oh my goodness.
It's brother.
Exactly. Kadesh be your name. What a... Again, what is our brothers talking about? Drop down to verse 12. See what the Mashiach says, though, according to scripture. Hebrew, read that.
Hebrews 2 and 12.
Okay.
Saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren.
You see that? I will do what?
I will declare thy name, your name unto my brethren.
You see that? What that mean to y'all? What that particular verse mean to y'all? You're supposed to know the name, right? If you are a brother of the Mashiach or a sister of the Mashiach, that name has been declared to you. Not, oh, well, that's a title. I'm not going to deal with that. I'm just going to call him Jesus. Right?
That's a name.
Because that, right. We speak English. No, brother. Psalms 22 and 22. Let's see this repeated in the so-called old. Because unfortunately, a lot of our brothers run around here talking about new covenant trump the old, right? No, they go hand in hand. Matter of fact, what Paul say to Timothy? These scriptures are for doctrine, correction, for instruction in righteousness. So everything that's stated in the new has to be validated by the old. They go hand in hand. But a lot of our brothers then went back into Christianity. Psalms 22 and 22. They what?
Advanced Christians.
Yeah, they advanced Christians. That's a good term, advanced Christians. But they know they're Israelites. You know what I'm saying? But they don't want to deal with the full, unadulterated, raw, and cut, uncut truth. Read that.
Tehillim or Psalms 22 and 22. I will declare thy name unto my brethren.
You see that again? This is what he was quoting. Because the Mashiach did do nothing but teach the law and uphold the prophets. They go hand in hand. Right? Get John 17 and 6. The book of John, chapter 17 and verse 6.
The Hukanah
17 and verse 6.
The Hukanah 17 and 6. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world.
You see that? So if you really dealing with the Mashiach, he manifested the name to you. Simple and plain, man. Drop down to verse. Matter of fact, keep reading.
Thine they were,
uh-huh.
And thou gavest them me,
mm-hmm.
And they have kept thy word.
So if we keep the word of the Most High, that means what? Keep the commandments. Fear his name. Don't violate it. Don't take it in vain. Don't blaspheme it. Uphold what the Mashiach and the Most High has done for us. Get John 12 and 28. The book of John chapter 12 and verse 28. Let's see what the Mashiach had to say. Did he say, Father... Give them a title. Father, take their name away. Let's see what he said.
John chapter 12 and 28. Father, glorify thy name.
You see that? Mashiach told him, put that esteem, Father, back on your name, because Israel then profaned it. Just like Ezekiel 36 shows. We profane the name of the Most High, even amongst captivity. We don't want to respect the Most High. Right? That's sad. Read on.
Abba. Esteem your name. Then came there a voice from Shamayim saying, I have both esteemed it.
Right, so he said, I already done glorified it. I done made these nations to fear it. I done put my name on the children of Israel. It's glorified. But what else?
And I will esteem it again.
You see that? He gonna glorify or highly esteem it again. So he gave it and he gonna do it again. So what is our brothers talking about again? Can't get caught up in that. Because this thing gonna hinge on your salvation. Matter of fact, get Matthew Matityahu chapter 28 verse 19. You received that baptism or go into that water. How was you supposed to do it? What the protocol? Oh my goodness. I know when I was young, I got baptized under Jesus. Wicked is all outdoors afterwards. To be honest. When you come into this truth and begin to learn to keep these commandments and get the real name, oh yeah, you get that spirit. Matityahu chapter 28, verse 19.
Matityahu chapter 28 and 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations.
You see that? That's what we commanded to do. Teach all the sons and daughters of Adam. Right? Read on.
Immersing them in the name of the Father.
Wait a minute. We don't have a name though. Did that say title?
Name.
Read.
In the name of the Father and the Son and the Ruach HaKodesh. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you.
You see that? That's proper protocol for baptism. Where that book go? That understand what you read. Where is that? Go back to page 5 and read. Read that again. He said something very profound in that. But he said, in the name of the Father and the name of the Son. Read this.
The prefix of Yah is found in both the Heavenly Father's name and his son's name, Yah, the Father.
Baptize him in the name of the Father.
And the Son.
And the Son.
Yah, the Son.
You see that? So the brother recognized that again. Y'all want to get your hands on this book? Get it. Have it for your reference. Understand what you read. A lot of our brothers have lost their understanding what they've been reading for all these years. For filthy lucre sake.
How does President Obama get to 270 electoral votes? Well, his clearly strongest voter group is African Americans, and hundreds of preachers and other religious leaders are going to get a pep talk of sorts from members of the Congressional Black Caucus on how to combat the recent rise in voter ID laws. I'm joined now by the chairman of the Congressional Black Caucus, Congressman Emmanuel Cleaver, Democrat from Missouri, who is also an ordained minister. Congressman, it's good to see you. Good morning.
Good to be with you.
So you've got this big summit tomorrow. Essentially, what is your message to several hundred clergy members, I understand, who will be there?
Yes, we'll have representatives from 9 denominations who actually pastor somewhere in the neighborhood of about 10 million people. And we're going to, first of all, equip them with the information they need to know about what they can say and what they cannot say in the church that would violate their 501c3 status with the IRS. In fact, we're going to have the IRS administrator there. We're going to have the Attorney General Eric Holder there. We're going to have the lawyers organization from around the country, the ACLU, all giving ministers guidance on what they can and cannot do.
Sad thing. Let's get Joel chapter 2 and verse 32. The book of Joel chapter 2 and verse 32. Again, this ain't a fight, none of our brothers or camp bang or none of that. But at the end of the day, if you really about the Most High, you got to represent the truth raw and uncut. Whether it be against the Christians, Islam, whatever. Even our brothers that's in this word, they ain't doing the right thing. This thing go for all of us. Joel chapter 2 and verse 32.
Joel 2 and 32. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of Yahuwah.
You see what? You see that? Wait a minute. What do shall mean?
It's going to happen. Something future.
Uh-huh.
And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of Yahuwah shall be delivered.
You see that? So us calling on the name of the Most High and the Mashiach, we're going to receive deliverance if we keep the law, statutes, and commandments in its entirety. Right? Get Acts 4 and 12. The book of Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. Acts chapter 4 and 12. Neither is there salvation in any other. Read that again, brother. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under Shamayim given among men whereby we must be saved. You see that? So this is crystal clear. There's no other name given among men that you shall receive salvation. Keep dealing with Jesus Christ and see if you're going to get some salvation. Keep dealing with Buddha or Allah and see if you get salvation. There's no other name under Shamayim given, man. That's why your L2 said what it said. Call on the name and you shall receive salvation. So let's continue to do that. Get at Exodus 23 and 13. Let's get a couple of warnings. And we're going to close it out. Exodus 23 and verse 13.
Exodus 23 and 13.
Uh-huh.
And in all things that I have said unto you, be circumspect.
So the Most High gave us a direct heeding. Everything he told us to do, be circumspect. Right? Read on.
And make no mention of the name of other gods.
Make what?
Make no mention of the name of other gods.
You see that? Nah, I'm going to be honest with you. This is one thing that I think we all violate on the regular basis. Right? How do we do that? Right. Exactly. The months, days of the week.
Even if you utter in astrology, the zodiac signs.
The zodiac signs. All the way down to Jesus Christ and all that other madness. Those is names of other deities. These Romans constructed that name and gave it to us. Flat out. So how would it say? Be circumspect and don't mention what?
And make no mention of the name of other gods. Neither let it be heard out of your mouth.
And that's something that we got to improve on. You know what I'm saying? I know amongst us, we all say, well, you know, we meet on the first day, or we meet on the second day, or whatever the case. We try to uphold that. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, when we're in the world, it's kind of hard because, you know, these people don't know what the first day of the week is.
They don't think about
it. You know what I'm saying? Or when our Eid is. They don't understand that. But it's something that we got to work on because we can't let these other deities' names be mentioned out of our mouth. Joshua 23 and verse 6. The brother wanted more. Where my two witnesses at, right? Here go his other witness. Joshua 23 and verse 6.
6 and 36.
Joshua 23 and verse 6.
Joshua 23 and 6. Be ye therefore very courageous.
You see that? So the Most High told us to be courageous. In this walk, we got to be strong as soldiers, men and women. Read on.
Be ye therefore very courageous to keep and to do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses.
You see that? So keep everything written in the book of the law of Moses. But them brothers say, no, if it's over in the New Testament and it should trump the old. No, brother, they go hand in hand again. Read.
That you turn not aside therefrom to the right hand or to the left.
Uh-huh. So that fire or that water don't turn to the right or to the left. Keep that straight and narrow path. Right? Read on.
That you come not among these nations, these that remain among you.
You see, and now, didn't we come among these nations? Brought into captivity around the world. So we came among them, but he said, he giving us a warning here. Read on.
That you come not among these nations, that these remain among you, neither make mention of the name of their gods, nor cause to swear by them, neither serve them, nor bow yourselves unto them.
You see that? So we ain't supposed to be dealing with these other nations' deities. And that's what we're doing, bowing down to it. Selling the Most High out, up the river. That's wicked in the sight of the Most High. Get Zechariah 13 and 1. Let's see what the Most High is going to do to all these pagan names. Zechariah chapter 13 and verse 1. The book of Zechariah, chapter 13 and verse 1.
Zechariah, who 13:1, in that day there shall be a fountain open to the house of David and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanness.
Man, I thought it was no baptism in the Old Testament. Ain't that what some people say? Ain't that what they say, B?
Yeah.
But he said he gonna open up a fountain to clean us up, right? Read on.
And that day there shall be a fountain open to the house of David and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanness.
Now notice this. When we come back, when we go back to our land, we're going to have to be fully cleaned up, right? But notice what he says in the second verse. Read on.
And it shall come to pass.
Wait a minute. Future tense again. Read.
And it shall come to pass in that day, saith the ruler of hosts or armies, that I will cut off the name of idols out of the land.
You see, at the Most High said he's going to cut off the names of all of these idols. Jesus Christ is an idol, people. Simple. That ain't the Mashiach written of. Read on.
And they shall no more be remembered.
They ain't going to be what?
No more remembered.
So the remembrance of that is going to be cut off out the nation of Israel's mouth and all nations. Right? Read on.
And I also will cause the prophets and the unclean spirits to pass out of the land.
You see that? So what is it showing you? These, you got false prophets running around here that uplift themselves, that's teaching fake names, and they've given our people an unclean spirit. That name, Jesus Christos, has a unclean spirit on it. Flat out. That's why that stronghold is so strong for our people. When you teach against that, what do? They're ready to fight you. They don't want you not taking my Jesus from me. Because it's an unclean spirit attack. With that, because that ain't the name of the Most High and the Mashiach.
They say, I seen demons cast out of that name. You cannot tell me, Jesus.
Right, but what did the Mashiach say in Matthew 7? I did this in your name. I cast out demons. I did. He gonna say, I don't even know you. Why? Because it starts with a name. How can you say you know somebody and then don't want to know their name? That don't even make sense. It starts with that. He gonna say, I don't even know you. You workers of what?
Iniquity.
Meaning lawlessness. Right, depart. Let's get John 3:18. A lot of people, you know, we read this scripture, especially in the church. But he said something else that was real profound in this particular setup right here. John 3:18. Yahuchanah, chapter 3:18. Showing you how pivotal this is to our salvation. It's very key. Read.
Yahuchanah 3:18, or John, he that believeth on me is not condemned.
You see that? So when you believe in the true and living Mashiach, you're not condemned. Keep the commandments, you won't receive condemnation. Read on.
But he that believeth not is condemned already.
And why is that?
Because he have not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of the Most High.
You see that? So a lot of our brothers went around here talking about they believe. But you don't believe in the name. That says you're condemned, brother. You know what I'm saying? You've got to believe in the name of the only begotten Son of the Most High. Not the son of what is his name? Cronus. A.K.A. Zeus.
Helios Christos.
Man, that's sad. Let's close it out. Let's get Psalms 91. Psalms 91 and pick it up at the first verse. A couple more scripts and we'll close this up. All praise to the Most High's name. This is one of my Yahuwah's favorite chapters right here. Something very key mentioned here. Psalms 91 and verse 1.
Tehillim or Psalms 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
You see that? So you want to dwell in that secret place of the Most High. You want him to look upon you and cover you with his wings. You want him to be there for you. Especially these last days coming up. Jacob's trouble is around the corner. And we're going to need to dwell under that shadow of the Most High. Drop down to verse 14.
Verse 14. Because he hath set his love upon me.
See that? So you really love the Most High. You do what? You keep the commandments. You say you love him and don't keep the commandments. You're a liar. And the truth is not what?
Not in you.
It ain't in you. Read.
Therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high.
Why is that?
Because he hath known my name.
Because he has known my name. Read that again.
Because he have set his love upon me. Therefore will I deliver him.
Uh-huh.
I will set him on high. Because he have known my name.
So that means you guard and protect the Most High's name and represent it righteously to the fullest. Get 2 Esdras chapter 2 and verse 40. Matter of fact, this is where we scroll down. We'll just get right to the crux of the matter. Verse 47. Nah, you're according to them, brother. You don't need the name to be get salvation. Just keep the commandments, but the name is in the commandments. 2 Esdras chapter 2 and verse, pick it up at verse 47. Very key, y'all. We've been blessed to know the name of the Most High and the Mashiach. Let's hold fast to that.
2:47, right?
Yeah, read that.
2 Esdras 2 and 47.
Now, this is the prophecy dealing with when the Mashiach comes on the scene and begins to bring that destruction upon planet Earth. And then separates the nation of Israel and those that want to deal with the truth. Bringing us into the kingdom. Read that.
2 Esdras 2 and 47. So he answered and said unto me, it is the Son of the Most High.
You see that? So a question was posed. Who was that tall brother passing out all them crowns? He taller than all of them. Right? He giving them an answer. It was the Son of the Most High, Mashiach. Read on.
Whom they have confessed in the world.
Uh-huh.
Then began I greatly to commend them.
You see that? So he started commending them, giving them a round of applause, being glad for them. Why is that?
Then greatly to commend them that stood so stiffly.
They did what?
Stood so stiffly.
For what?
For the name of the Master.
You see that? We stand stiffly for the name of the Most High. Don't budge. When these people come with these other doctrines and all that, trying to take the name of the Most High away, don't budge. Get Psalm 69 and verse 35. The book of Psalms chapter 69 and verse 35.
Psalms of Tehillim 69 and 35.
Uh-huh.
For the Most High will save Zion and will build the cities of Judah that they may dwell there and have it in possession.
You see that again? This is future tense. Right? Read on.
The seed also of his servant shall inherit it.
Uh-huh.
And they shall love his name.
Now read that again.
And they that love his name shall dwell therein.
You see that? You love the name of the Most High, you're going to dwell back in Zion. I mean, I don't know how much more clear it can get. Drop back to Psalms 20 and 5. They that love his name, love the name of Yahuwah. That's our power.
Psalms 20 and 5. We will rejoice in thy salvation and in the name of our power.
You see that? We're going to rejoice in our salvation. Yahusha, who is the salvation of the Most High. Right? Read on.
And in the name of our power, we will set up our banners.
We will do what?
We will set up our banners.
So what's a banner? What do that represent? Huh? Right. Like a flag. We're going to set up our banners in the name of the Most High. But what is these brothers setting up their names in? They banners in, brother.
Christos.
Exactly. Sad, man. Read on.
Yahuwah, fulfill all thy petitions. Now know I that Yahuwah saveth his anointed. He will hear him from his Kodesh Shamaim with the saving strength of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of Yahuwah our power.
We will do what?
We will remember the name of Yahuwah our power.
So are we supposed to forget the name of the Most High, y'all? Not at all. Is it done away with?
Not at all.
Remember the name of the Most High. You're going to get that salvation. One final scripture. Psalms 135 and 13.
That's like how they took away the Shabbat.
Exactly.
It say remember
the Shabbat day, right?
Remember the Shabbat day.
Right. Because they tried to make us forget. But he said, we're going to remember the name of the Most High. Psalms 135 and verse 13. Last scripture. Psalms 135 and verse 13.
Psalms 135 and verse 13. Thy name.
Thy what?
Thy name.
Thy title.
Thy name.
Thy translation.
Thy name.
Thy substitution.
Thy name.
Does what?
O Yahuwah, endureth forever.
It endured. The name of the Most High endures forever, brothers and sisters. Simple. It ain't taken away. It ain't hidden no more. Because we in the spirit. The Most High got. We got us. Right? Read on.
And thy memorial.
Thy what?
Thy memorial. O Yahuwah, throughout all generations.
And again, that goes back to Exodus 3 and 15. So by the spirit of the Most High, let's uphold the Most High's name forever. And uplift it. Because he's worthy of that. So with that, I say Shabbat Shalom. And may the Most High, Yahuwah, Baha Shem, Yahusha, be with you.
Right.